At 737 now, 737 with 101.3 Augusta, 103.9 Bangor, the voice of Maine. Senate President Kevin Raye at the ceremonial signing of LD 1274 yesterday, dealing with what is some consider the arcane education funding formula in the state of Maine, an act to restore equity in said funding formula. Mr. President, what does this formula actually, or what does this measure actually seek to do with the existing formula?
Hey, good morning, Rick. There are three provisions of the law that are designed to address. It doesn't by any means make rural Maine whole when it comes to the EPS formula, but it does remove some of the most biased language from the formula. For instance, it removes a provision in the existing formula that subjects the state reimbursement for school personnel benefits to the labor market index. In other words, you have the exact same benefits being paid everywhere in the state, but they reimburse you in a flawed manner. So if you're in Biddeford and Saco, you get reimbursed for 110%, whereas if you're in Washington County, you get reimbursed for 82%. So we struck that from the law, which is a major win for rural Maine. Second provision is it acknowledges that in the rural areas where you have, you know, a spread out district, sometimes 10, 12, 14 towns in one district, but you only have, say, 1,000 kids, there's no way that you can have enjoy these same economies of scale that you would if you are in a major urban area. So it allows a 10% increase in the staffing ratio for school districts of less than 1,200 kids. Not for teacher-student ratios, but for staffing. In other words, you know, if you have a school, there's got to be a school secretary, whether you've got 800 kids or 150 kids. You got to have basic staff to run the school. And the third piece is that for the first time, it injects into the formula a measure of a community's ability to pay. And that's very important for a lot of the little towns that have either lakes or ocean frontage, and they're property rich, but the population is poor. And so what it does is it injects a measure into the formula that takes a look at the number of kids in the community that are eligible for free and reduced lunch. And if you have more than 50% of your kids eligible for free and reduced lunch, it adds a new additional minimum subsidy for those property-rich but low-income population communities. So those are the three provisions, and I think one of the reasons the bill was successful, that whether your district gained as a result of it or not, it was very difficult to look at those three provisions and argue that they're not common sense. And so the legislation was successful and signed into law yesterday.
Well, it was your bill. It was your work. It was 1274. I'm sure you've called it a victory for rural Maine. Even though budgets are already in place, the larger communities now will find less funding.
Oh, actually, no, that's not true, George. The recognizing that the budgets may already be in place for the coming school year, this does not take effect until the year 2012 and 13. It's being done in conjunction with the infusion of an additional $19 million of state money, so that no community will receive less money. In other words, every community in Maine will see an increase in funding because of the new level of funding being provided. It's just that some of the communities that have been benefiting from the flaws in the system at the expense of rural Maine will see an increase, but it won't be as large of an increase as they might have gotten under the old formula.
So it's a way to eliminate the inequities between the rural and the urban.
Exactly, yeah, and we tried to do it very thoughtfully in a way that was combined with the infusion of new money so that no community would actually lose real dollars.
on the telephone with the Senate President Kevin Raye from, we're guessing you're either in Perry this morning or at
That's
the Mill
right,
at Eastport.
That's right, in a very foggy Perry, Maine.
Understood. On the George Hale Rick Tyler Show, the signing ceremonially yesterday of 1274, a victory for fairness and common sense, as you said. Hopefully this will repair the damage, a quote from you, repair the damage done to rural education over six devastating years. The damage is already done for some.
It has been done for some, and that's the really unfortunate part. You know, when this law was put in under Governor Baldacci, those of us from rural areas objected from the very outset because you could see the handwriting on the wall. And just, let me just give you an example of the devastating impact EPS has had in rural Maine. You may recall that EPS came into effect on the same day that $250 million in new education funding went on the books. Remember the referendum that we had 5 or 6 years ago to put more money into education? Well, it passed. And so on July 1st of that fiscal year, $250 million in new education money went out to the schools on the same day that EPS took effect. And do you know what the impact of that was in Washington County? With $250 million in new money, you might think all boats would be lifted. Yet in Washington County, the poorest county in the state, we actually lost $2 million on that day because of EPS and the flawed manner in which it worked. And that played out over and over across rural Maine, primarily, in smaller communities. It was really, I believe, a formula that was designed to force school closures and consolidations, and it was really devastating to communities. So we fought it for six long years, and it took a new governor and a new legislature for us to get it passed.
Well, that brings to, at least for the moment, that to a close. The summer recess is in operation, and you can worry about mustard instead of worrying about...
Exactly.
But we can talk a little bit. The governor departed a little bit from the norm when the legislature closed, and he had some victories, and he like every governor, RRD, had some he wasn't happy with. But he really threw the gauntlet down for January again, didn't he?
Well, he did. He mentioned, a couple things on his agenda that he wants to take up in the second session. And it shouldn't surprise anybody that this governor departs from the norm. This governor, he's in many respects, he's a breath of fresh air. He comes into Augusta as an outsider, somebody who's been in the business world. He has shaken things up, and I think in many respects that's been a very positive thing. There certainly were some bumps in the way early on in terms of some of his public comments, but I have to say that it's been several months now since that's happened. The governor has, I think he's really buckled down, been very serious-minded, and he's been extremely successful with his agenda. Largest tax cuts in the history of Maine, welfare reform. He doesn't get a lot of credit for this. It hasn't been mentioned much by the media, but he's probably one of the few governors in the country, not the only, who's been able to increase education funding and as part of this budget. I think that's an extraordinary accomplishment. Not a dime of cuts to higher ed, and millions in additional money for K through 12, really sort of putting his money where his mouth is when he said he wanted to be the education governor. And I think if you look at the rest of the states, Maine really stands out in that regard.
Kevin, I'll take the risk of cutting into sports time and get a scowl from George, but I'd like to ask your opinion.
We lost yesterday.
I ask you an opinion on one thing, and that is a countywide vote for table games at Hollywood slots, but not a countywide vote for Washington County on the prospects of a gaming facility for the tribe.
Yeah, well, certainly a disappointment to me on the latter, but I do support countywide votes. I think that that should be the norm. The reason that we couldn't do that for Washington County, though I had proposed it and I had intended to advance a bill to do that, but it became clear that because the Washington County Racino and the Biddeford Racino were brought to us by a citizen initiative, it wasn't a legislator who brought it forward, it was a citizen initiative, it would have become a competing measure. It would have had to go on the ballot for the fall, and it would have been, I think, just mass confusion. So it didn't work to do it this time for the Washington County Racino, but I very much like establishing the precedent. And, you know, I have no problem with the referendum for Penobscot County for table games. And I think that that's the precedent that we should follow in the future.
Well, we'll end the discussion with someone who's been involved in this from day one. I will say this much. As I look around the country, Maine is about the only state now that doesn't have a comprehensive plan on gambling.
Absolutely. And that has been, I think, a real failure. And I have a bill in, George, you may be aware of, that's been held over to the second session because we wanted to see what happens with the referenda this fall. But I have a bill in that could be the vehicle for a comprehensive look at gaming. We need to recognize that we are a gaming state. We need to have policies in place, and we can't just keep lurching from statewide referendum to statewide referendum with the legislature sloughing off its responsibility to the voters.
From his home in Perry this morning, Senate President Kevin Raye, sir, you know the phone number. You're welcome back anytime for the George Elrick Tyler Show.
Thanks so much. Have a great summer, guys.